Hello, this is Dr. Janisch. This video is going to be an open reduction internal fixation of a ring finger fracture. This fracture is in the proximal phalanx, and you can see that it's oblique. We're going to be marking the skin incision again with a skin marker. I have several options here. Some surgeons go directly through the middle of the finger on the dorsal surface or the top, the back of the hand. I like to go along the side if I can, and that helps me stay out of the extensor tendon, which is nice for post-operative healing. In this particular patient, we've marked the incision along the side of the finger. We're testing the anesthetic here with some forceps, making sure that the patient's hand is numb and they're comfortable. This particular surgery is being done under a beer block. The incision is made with a 15-blade scalpel, being very careful to protect the underlying structures. And then we dissect down using littler scissors and add some forceps to the level of the extensor tendon and the bone. Bipolar cautery is used for some minor cauterization. You can now see the extensor tendon mechanism coming into view. There's a few final blood vessels which we did buzz with the bipolar. The extensor tendon has been retracted, and now we're visualizing the periosteum of the bone. Which has been incised gently, and I'm using a small key elevator to elevate the periosteum off of the fracture site. In this particular situation, I'm being very careful to minimize the periosteal elevation. This is the blood supply to the bone, and we want as much of this to remain as possible. You can see the fracture line there. I'll use some suction to try to get out some of the blood clot and fibrin tissue that's been deposited there since the patient's initial injury. I'm now going to be placing some fracture reduction forceps across the fracture site, and this is a clamp that essentially just holds the fracture together like a little miniature vise. I'm trying to position the fracture line right now, and as soon as I get it lined up, I'll squeeze down on the clamp, and that holds the fracture steady. This can sometimes be fairly tricky. You can't squeeze specific anatomical structures, and the fracture clamp has to be out of the way of where you're going to be drilling and working. Now I'll be using a drill to drill across both fracture segments, and I'm going to be doing a lag screw technique. This is where I use a small drill bit to drill across both walls of the bone, and then I'm going to be coming in with a second drill bit, which is slightly larger, the same size as the threads of the screw, and I will drill only the first wall of the bone, the proximal cortex. This is the second drill bit. I then use a depth gauge, which is extremely small and tight to get through both holes. This measures the length of the screw, and I confirm that on X-ray. The depth gauge is then removed carefully, not to disrupt the fracture. This hole has already been countersunk with a separate drill bit. That part didn't get filmed, and the screw goes in, which has been properly measured, and seats nicely, pulling the fracture together well. In proper lag technique, this screw is actually only biting into the distal cortex, or the wall of the bone furthest away from the head of the screw. One screw is seated nicely, and we'll drill the hole for the second screw. This is the smaller of the two drill bits, which will go through and through the entire bone. Followed by the secondary drill bit. For the lag screw, this is a slightly larger and is only going across the proximal cortex, or the wall of the bone closest to the head of the screw. This particular screw hole, I'm doing this by hand for a little bit finer control. Then we'll use the countersink, which wasn't shown on the first screw. That makes the bone a little bit wider where the head of the screw will be, and the screw can seat down nicely. And then we'll use the depth gauge to measure the length of this screw and confirm that on fluoroscopy. That's then carefully removed, and we'll place our screw. This screw is also seated quite nicely and is also confirmed on fluoroscopy. At this point, I'm going to check for alignment of the fingers. Doing a technique called tenodesis, which allows the fingers to move through their normal, relaxed anatomical arc, and I'm making sure that the ring finger does not scissor over the middle or the small finger. It's very well aligned, and take some time to confirm the alignment of this before we proceed. The wound is then irrigated with saline. Begin a layered closure. The periosteum was closed over the top of the bone with 4-0 monocle suture, and now you're seeing the skin closure with 5-0 nylon. I'm doing a running mattress technique. You'll see me leave a small loop of suture in the middle of the wound, which will allow for easier removal. Therefore, the nurse in the office, when the patient comes back, can clip both ends of the suture and then one right in the middle and pull it out from either direction. You'll also notice that the wound edges are what we call everted, where the wound seems to be puckered up slightly from the stitching. This is done very intentionally and allows for a much better looking scar. And this will heal quite nicely. We then put in some local anesthetic so that the patient's finger is nice and numb when their anesthetic wears off. This numbing medicine will stay around for about 4 to 5 hours and allows for a much more comfortable recovery phase. When the beer block is let down, the patient's arm does wake up fairly rapidly, and therefore this will stay around, making their finger numb for the next 5 hours. We placed a xeriform dressing over the surgical incision, and now we'll place a bulky splint. Some fluffs go between the patient's fingers, followed by a bulky gauze and a Curlex. After the Curlex comes a fiberglass one-step splint, which has been trimmed to fit. That's been dipped in water to activate it, and we wrap with a soft Coban dressing. Although this looks like a cast, it's actually a soft material going around the one-sided fiberglass splint. We'll then mold the splint into a safe position where the fingers are straight and bent at the knuckles. At about 60 to 70 degrees, and this allows for the best healing. Thank you for watching. That's the end of this video.